A large part of logical or technical access control are things we've talked about already. This is the authentication part of the IAAA model where I said I am Thor and I now have to prove that with multi-factor authentication. Now what I get access to and which type of access control models we use depends on our organization and what is important to us. So we have done the authentication, now we do the authorization. And we use the different types of access control models to determine what a subject is allowed to access. And this is a good point to tie this back to the basics of all IS, IT, and cybersecurity, the CIA triad. If confidentiality is more important than everything else, we would most likely use mandatory access control. Now, if availability was more important, we would likely go with discretionary access control. And if integrity is most important, then we would either choose RBAC, role-based access control, or ABAC, attribute-based access control. And just to make sure you don't confuse any of these with rule-based access control, RULEBAC, that is what we use for our firewalls. If this happens, then do that. It's the if-then statements. Since we have already talked about these, I'm not going to go super much in depth, but for the curriculum, but logical access control makes sense both to have here and in domain 1. So let's look at DAC again, discretionary access control. And as the name indicates, this is based on the discretion of the data owner. It is at their discretion who and what they grant access to. The data owner can add and remove rights, or they can remove the access entirely. This is what most operating systems use. You can share your drive or a folder on that drive with someone else, and it uses DACLs, discretionary access lists. For specific folders, someone can grant me read and write access to one folder, but not to another. And most of the places where you're going to see DAC is maybe on shared drives. If you are in an organization in the private sector and you have role-based access control, you can still have discretionary access control within that. So you have a shared drive with all the files for your team. But the issue here is that we need someone who keeps track of all the files in there because we need to make sure that there are no orphaned files. Meaning if it's just somewhere where we stuff everything, very soon it's going to get cluttered and you can't really find anything. There's just too much stuff we don't use anymore. On top of that, people also choose to protect their files with passwords. But what happens when they leave? And this is a critical file. If we don't have that password, that file is no longer usable. And how I talked about we can use discretionary access control within role-based access control, that's really true for many of the combinations. We don't have to have one or another. We can have one major access control type. In most private companies and organizations, it's role-based or attribute-based, but then below that, in certain areas, we can have other types. Next up, we have MAC, Mandatory Access Control. And you can tell from the name, right? This is more serious. It's mandatory. Here, confidentiality is most important, and access to objects is determined by labels and clearance. Subjects have clearance, objects have labels. Subjects can manipulate objects. Some things can be both, but not at the same time. And the clearance have to be equal to or supersede the label. If you logic your way through it a few times, it will make sense. If we have a program that does our backups, if you go in and you configure things, at that point, that program is the object. It's being manipulated by you. Now, at midnight when our backups start, the backup program is now the subject. It goes out and pulls all the data that we need from the servers we're backing up. The servers are the object. All right, back to MAC. And MAC is heavily used in the military and with defense contractors, which makes sense, right? We want to keep those secrets very secret. There are a few places I have seen it in the private sector, but again here, it's places where if we're compromised, the consequences could be really grave. And when I say the clearance must dominate the object's label, meaning it has to be equal to or higher than, it's not always that simple. If this is military, even if you have top secret, doesn't mean you can see everything that's top secret. You're going to have specific that can be top secret, nuclear, submarine. Well, then you can access top secret material about nuclear submarines. But here again, just because you can doesn't mean you're allowed to. There could also be a need to know here. Then we have RBAC, role-based access control. We have touched on that a couple of times. This is when integrity is most important. And this is what the vast majority of the private sector uses. It's policy neutral access control, and it's defined around roles and privileges, and access is assigned to a job role. You are a cybersecurity analyst, well then you get cybersecurity analyst rights. If you are a network administrator, well then you get network administrator rights. And this most of the time comes with a need to know. We give you access to way more than you need to do your day-to-day job. But for you to be allowed to access that data, you have to have a need to know. This was the example I had with the doctors. They are allowed to access that specific patient's records if they are treating them. There was a case when Natalie Sulman, the woman that had 8 babies, Octomom, when she gave birth, part of her information was leaked to the press. We don't know who did it, but there were 15 employees at Kaiser that were not treating her. By accessing her records, they violated the need to know. And all of those nurses and doctors either got reprimanded or fired. And if you look at the image here, how the different roles of the thousands of users and the tens of thousands of permissions we have become much easier to manage. So everybody has access to the general role. They have email, they have time cards, they have employee records. And then we have a list with access control rights for that specific job. So as a cybersecurity analyst, you have the general role, you have IT role, you might have a cybersecurity analyst role. So anyone that joins us, we don't just make a copy of my access rights for the new employee. We have a role for cybersecurity analysts and they get assigned that. And the reason we don't just copy an existing user profile and use that as the template for the new one, I know many places do this, is because what if I have other roles? What if I'm not only the cybersecurity analyst? What if I have access to the data center or to some of the networking equipment? So we give the new users the access using the template for that specific position. And if anything needs to be changed, we change it, but we also document it very, very clearly. And if anyone ever changes roles within the organization, we need to remove the old rights and add the new rights. That way, Bob doesn't move from making the purchase orders to signing the checks and keeps both rights so he can both make the order and pay for it. That's just trouble asking to happen. Role-based access control is by far the most common type of access control, but there is a shift towards ABAC, attribute-based access control, so let's look at that now. With ABAC, we have the same subjects and objects, but we also have environmental conditions. That was the one where if I'm a cybersecurity analyst, I don't have rights to enter the data center, but if I'm working on a project for the server team and I need to be in the data center because of that environmental condition, I now have access to the data center. It is the who, what, where, when, why, and how. We can also configure it to where nurses can only access records for patients they're actively treating. If they try to access anything else, they will get denied. This is probably not the best place to be super aggressive about this, because sometimes they are going to be treating patients before they have them assigned. In that case, we might just have a confirmation screen saying something like, "We don't see this being an active patient of yours. Are you sure you want to access this patient record?" Then there's some sort of disclaimer. There might be consequences if you access this patient record and you should not. So with attribute-based access control, it's much, much more granular and it's more secure than role-based access control. But here, we also need to make sure, because it is so complex, it is more granular, we also need to configure it completely right. This is going to take more time, but it will give us much more flexibility in our organization. Today, it's used in maybe 25% of large enterprises, and we expect that to be up to 70% within the next 5 years. In most places, you are going to see it as ABAC attribute-based, but you can see it some other places as policy-based or claims-based access control. And then let's revisit context and content-based access control. And some of what we do in context-based access control can be rolled into ABAC, attribute-based. Here, access and access control is based on certain contextual parameters. That's why it's context-based. We can give subjects access based on their time or their location. It can be a sequence of responses, their access history, or some sort of other context. That's what we did at that bank. The credit card department can log in to those programs half an hour outside of their normal work hours from the PCs only at the location. Meaning if I worked in that credit card department, and even if I could log in remotely, if I try to log in to my PC outside of my normal work hours, I won't get access. It could also be a challenge response mechanism, like what is your favorite stuffed toy animal? Whether you like to go on vacation, access is granted based on the context and what they're trying to access. If any of those parameters are not met, access is denied. And context really just means circumstances. If the circumstances aren't right, you don't get access. And you need to not confuse this with content-based access control. The content is what you're trying to access. If we go back to the hospital example, we have the same program that are used by nurses, doctors, physical therapists, pharmacists. Depending on their job role, they get shown one set of information and one set of menus. Nurses and pharmacists are going to see different things because different things are important to them. So really, content-based access control is really us hiding or showing menus and information in the applications, the views, the databases, access to confidential information based on the subject and the content they're trying to access. And with that, we are done with this lecture. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next one.